Okay, good day, ladies and gentlemen. So in this video, we're going to look at something called primary keys. By the end of the video, you should be able to explain why primary keys are important. You should be able to create a table to use the primary keys, and you need to be able to explain the rules of primary keys. Let me just say that in every IGCSE paper that I've looked at, there's always a question related to primary keys. So it's a very important concept, both within the database and in computing in general. So it's important to make sure you understand how these things work. So let's just think about this as the reason why we have primary keys. Let's think about this problem here. Imagine you've got this table of teachers, and imagine you want to do an update on one of the teachers, or you want to delete one of the teachers, for instance, from the table. Well, at the moment, every field in the record is identical. So there's John Smith, Prep, Maths. Now, this may not sound like it happens very often, but it is quite common, actually. It's especially in countries where people have the same name. So you quite often get two people with the same name working in the same unit. So what we need is a way to uniquely identify each row. So for instance, if this John Smith here is the guy who's leaving, and I run delete where first name equals John, family name equals Smith, senior prep equals prep, subject equals maths, it's going to delete both of these two row records, which is not what we want. Okay, so a primary key is a field that we use to uniquely identify a record. Okay, you can think of it like a username or an ID number. Now, a primary key must be unique and not null. These are the rules of the primary key, of using primary keys. Okay, so as I said, there's always a question on these things in exams, so you must understand these rules. Primary keys must be unique, meaning that one primary key identifies one record, and they must be not null, so every record has a primary key. Okay, and primary keys can either be existing fields. Sometimes the data set that you're looking at has something that you can use as a primary key within it. But usually we generate an ID. So let's say, for instance, we're looking at this table of people. I've got names, ICAMA numbers, passport numbers, phone numbers, and emails. So if we say, which of these fields can I use as a primary key? Okay, so take a quick look and think about it. Which one of these fields can be used as a primary key, remembering that it has to be unique and not null. Right, so can we use email? Well, no, because not everybody has an email. And sometimes families share an email. So for instance, I'll quite often get emails from pupils using their parents' email account. So you can't rely on an email to uniquely identify a person. Phone numbers are the same. Not everyone has a phone, and usually a phone number sometimes a phone number is linked to a house, and everybody within that house has the same phone number. So it's not unique. What a phone number does not uniquely identify a single person. Passports, no. Because a passport, not everybody has a passport. So not everybody has a passport number. So where Tim Williams doesn't have a passport number, it would be null. So a passport number is not a good choice for primary key. Now, however, an ICAMA number, everybody in Saudi Arabia has an ICAMA number or a visa ID. So, and they're all unique, and it's impossible to be not known. Well, every legal citizen. So an ICAMA number would be a good choice for a primary key. Now, sometimes there isn't a good choice for a primary key, so we're gonna create a field. So naturally, a person doesn't have a person ID, okay? But we're going to create a field called person ID, and we're going to populate it with a unique ID so that we can uniquely identify each record. Tim Williams is record number 3. So when we create a primary key, when we are creating our tables, we can tell the table which field is going to be a primary key, and it'll perform various tests for us. So for instance, here we're creating a table of people. I've got a new field called person ID, which is going to be an integer, and I'm telling the database it's going to be my primary key. And then I've got a field of name, which is going to be of data type text. So if I then do insert into people values 1, so this is going to be my primary key, and then person 1, this line, this first line here will work. It'll be fine. When I try to run this next line, where I'm trying to do person 2 and have a duplicate primary key, this line will fail because the database will say, hang on a minute, you're trying to add two people with the same ID, and you've told me not to allow you to do that, so I'm going to stop you. Okay? So this insert here will fail and you'll get a big red error. And then this line here, this insert into people, where we're inserting null into the primary key, this will fail too. Because we're saying the primary key is, it's a primary key, so it shouldn't be null. Now some databases will allow you to have one null, but they won't allow two records to have null. But in general, it's a case that you can't allow null here. Now in the previous example, we were giving a value for the primary key. Most databases have this idea as well, something called auto increment. So we can have a field called person ID integer, which is a primary key auto increment. And if you've noticed now, when I insert into people, I'm not providing the person ID field, and I'm not providing a value. All that will happen here is that this will become 1, this will become 2, and this will become 3. And that will be the an auto-generated key. So we don't have to worry about remembering what the last key we implemented was. The database will just say the last one I gave was 10, the next one is 11. Okay, so that's the theory behind primary keys. In the next video, we'll look at how we go about creating them and using them. And I hope to see you all there.